Local programming on KRWG made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Anthony Moreno. Thanks for joining us for Fronteras, a Changing America. In 2003, StoryCorps was launched with a recording booth in New York City's Grand Central Station. The mission was to provide an opportunity for people from all backgrounds and beliefs to share their stories of their lives and have those stories preserved. Today, those stories are archived in the Library of Congress, and now it's even easier for you to record those stories on your smartphone with the StoryCorps app. We'll learn more about that also today. StoryCorps is coming to Las Cruces in January, and people across the Mesilla Valley will have an opportunity to record and archive their own stories of their lives. And here to tell us more about that opportunity is Jordan Bullard, manager of the mobile tour with StoryCorps. Jordan, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
I'd like to hear a little bit about, for people who don't know what StoryCorps is really, I mean, if we do have some NPR listeners in the audience, they know that on Fridays they can hear it during Morning Edition, but if you could share with our audience, you may not be too familiar with it.
Right, so StoryCorps is an oral history project at its core. And we were started more than 10 years ago now, 13 years ago, by our founder Dave Isay, who was a radio guy from the very start. And he sort of found out that when you sort of turn the microphone around and give people the ability to record their own stories, it really kind of changes things. And so we found that as an oral history project, we go into different communities across the country and basically give people the opportunity to record their own stories as they know it and as they tell it. And we do that on our mobile tour. We visit 10 different cities a year. And we have other locations across the country where folks can record their stories. And obviously for radio listeners, they know that they can hear StoryCorps on the air every Friday morning, like you mentioned. But we have, you know, more than 50,000 stories that have been recorded that are archived in the Library of Congress, like you mentioned. So it's a really great living archive for what life in the United States is like these past 10, 12, 13 years.
It would seem that it'd be pretty interesting if you could just go back to 2003 and listen to those original ones and compare them to what you might hear now. I mean, a lot of similarities, but I'd imagine there's some differences as well.
Yeah, I think so. You know, by and large, we find that people's stories are sort of intrinsically similar. You know, we live in this place, we live in the United States, we're all sort of part of this greater story. But within that story, there are people who, you know, the story from Las Cruces is going to be a lot different from a story from New York City or from a place in North Carolina or maybe out on the West Coast. So it's really, I think, our differences within each of the stories that we tell that sort of come together to form this larger sort of American story, this American history that we've been able to archive and record. So yeah, some differences, some similarities. I mean, the humanity of it all is what comes through, I think.
Well, you talked about Las Cruces, and we mentioned that the StoryCorps trailer is going to be here in Las Cruces. How do people go about in getting to share their stories while the trailer is here?
Right. So it's a public service. It's totally free to participate. You'll probably, if you're a radio listener, people will be hearing promos on air here if they listen to the local NPR radio station. But appointments will be available to people to sign up starting December 21st. And they're first come, first served. So if people want to record, they should probably sign up quickly. Signups go through our website, storycorps.org. And then our first day of recording is January 4th, and we will record in Las Cruces from January 4th to January 31st. So it's first come, first serve. Anybody that has access to a computer, we also have an 800 number. Anybody who's able to call that number can record a story with us. And it's totally open and free to the public.
Okay, and we do want to let the audience know also that you can visit our website, krwg.org, to find a link to reserve your spot with the StoryCorps. It was just, I believe, 3 years ago that StoryCorps was here in the Mesilla Valley last time?
3 or 4 years ago, something like that, yeah.
Okay, now how many people do you record on each visit?
That's a really good question. So we're here for about a month, and we try to stay as busy as possible. So we record 7 stories a day, 5 days a week, and that usually equals out to somewhere around 140 stories per city that we visit. And it's a conversational model, so that we ask that two people come in who know each other well to share their story. It could be a sibling or a spouse, grandmother, grandfather, somebody like that. And so that usually equals out to about 300 people are able to sort of experience telling their story, sharing their story in our Airstream in any given city that we visit. And that should be about the same here in Las Cruces.
Okay, well, I'm also curious. You said it's about 40 minutes each interview.
Yep, that's correct.
Now, as somebody who also works in radio, I'm a little also curious about how long does it take to edit about each one?
That's a great question. So, and obviously, once our stories are recorded in our Airstream trailer that's traveling around the country all over the place, we have to get it back to our offices in Brooklyn, which is where we're headquartered, in Brooklyn, New York. And then from there, as a radio person, you probably know that it takes a long time. We have, keywords that we might be looking for to produce some of these stories. It might be particularly relevant to a national holiday or something in the news or something like that. So it takes a long time to sift through those 40 minutes to see, because a lot of people cough, their bracelets move around and make noise. Some people cry, believe it or not, in StoryCorps interviews. So we have to sort of edit all of that out, because we go from 40 minutes down to the broadcast interview is usually about 3 minutes. But one important thing that I'd like to point out is less than 1% of the stories that we record end up being broadcast nationally. So when folks come to sign up for an interview, it's important just to come and have a natural conversation with someone that you know and love. It's not the opportunity to get your voice on the radio. It's an opportunity to really share an experience with someone that means a lot to you. And also the opportunity to have your voice recorded and archived in the Library of Congress, where the record of your story, your history, your experience will be archived in perpetuity, basically forever.
Now, you mentioned keywords and what you look for. I know many people, when they think of StoryCorps, they think of some really powerful emotional moments.
Sure.
Do you guys try to make people cry?
No, I don't. I don't know what it is about being in the Airstream. It's a very very cozy, sort of intimate environment. And it's an interesting thing when you turn sort of the microphone around and allow people, sort of empower people to share their own stories and have these moments where it's a safe space. They can ask that burning question they've always wanted to ask someone. Maybe they finally get to ask their grandfather about his childhood. Maybe they ask about, why did someone in their life make a decision that they made so many years ago? And when you ask big, meaningful questions like that, I think oftentimes it elicits emotion, And sometimes, sometimes their stories are funny. Sometimes they make you think. Sometimes they make you cry. But, it can be easy once you finally sit down. We get so busy with our computers and our tablets and our jobs and everyday life. When you finally sit down to have a quiet conversation with someone, it's kind of easy to get emotional, I think, especially when you start thinking about the kind of questions that you want to ask people.
One of the, as someone who works in radio, one of the most powerful things I've always found is that it has this intimate ability to connect with people. How does that relate with the mission of StoryCorps?
Well, I think the mission of StoryCorps obviously is to provide people from all backgrounds, from all walks of life, with the ability to share their story, basically. And I think that, when we are able to sort of broadcast that generally, and when we hear like, oh, so-and-so from this other corner of the country that I never even thought of has a story similar to mine, all of a sudden and it's in our ears, it's such an intimate thing. Someone is telling an intimate story and we're hearing it in an intimate way. I think that's one of the reasons why StoryCorps is so powerful and so moving.
One of the things about StoryCorps that I find interesting is that it has many initiatives that it's really focused on. I wonder if you could share with our audience some of the initiatives that are in place,
sure,
or have been in place in the past year for folks to tell their stories.
Right, and so we have a lot of different initiatives. You know, we have our Historias initiative, which is our initiative that is used to help archive and collect stories from Latin Americans across the country. Just a few other examples, our Griot initiative is an initiative that we use to sort of enable folks from African American communities across the country to share their stories. We also have Military Voices initiative, which that's pretty self-explanatory, but you know, especially nowadays with so many of our folks in the military community spread out across the entire globe, really, it's really important to provide those folks with the opportunity to also sit down, take a moment to share their stories. And I think that's that by and large is what we try to do across the board with our initiatives, to provide people with the opportunity who may not otherwise know about us, who may not otherwise have access to really share their stories, and for folks to, you know, maybe we sort of break down a barrier about what we maybe thought about the military community, that, oh, well, yeah, these people go through some pretty serious experiences. Other initiatives that we've had the Out Loud initiative, which records stories of the LGBTQ community across the country. And again, it's just providing access to people of all walks of life, all backgrounds, just playing right into our mission statement of trying to bring in people and have an honest representation of sort of the story of the United States. It can't be a one-sided story. If we say we're going to do what we're going to do, we have to provide this opportunity to people from all different backgrounds. And that's one of the crux of our initiative work, is trying to reach sort of beyond the folks who would normally listen to us on the radio, to provide the services that the service that we do to folks so that they can get their voices heard.
Well, I know that service this year with the announcement of the StoryCorps app, mm-hmm, provided that service to many more folks,
right,
who aren't probably able to get to the van or the trailer and visit the community where it was, because now they could record their stories on their smartphone. Could you,
yep,
share with us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so back in March of this year, our founder, Dave Isay, was awarded with a TED Prize, which means he got to go and give a TED Talk and talk about his vision of being able to provide basically everyone with the opportunity to record a StoryCorps story. And that manifested itself in our mobile app, which is this really cool thing. You know, so many of us have smartphones now. You can just pull it out of our pocket and hit the StoryCorps app, and you can record a story right there. There's a whole toolkit with, you know, questions that you can ask your interview partner. It walks you through the entire process of recording a story. And so if you happen to be in a distant corner of the country where our Airstream isn't there, if you're not close to one of our story booths, you could use the app to record a story. And similarly, you know, we'll be in Las Cruces recording from January 4th to January 31st. If you all of a sudden you have this epiphany and you want to participate in StoryCorps in February, use the app. You know, we love to have people come in. We love to welcome folks from the community into our Airstream, but we know that we can't accommodate everyone. And so if you find once we leave town and go on to our next destination, if you want to participate, the app is a really great way to do that.
Okay. Now, I was curious, is the sound quality pretty good still on the app?
I would say pretty good is a good way to describe it. You know, obviously it's not, unless just anybody out there has access to a padded studio, you know, that's nice and sealed off and all that kind of stuff, it will record whatever else is going on around you. So if you really want to have a nice sort of StoryCorps-esque experience, try to find a nice quiet interior room, maybe turn the AC off for an hour so you don't have any buzzing or anything like that. But you know, it's really, for us, I don't think it's so much about the sound quality, it's really about giving people the opportunity to have that experience, to have that quiet 40 minutes with someone that they love, to ask that burning question, to record that story, to have it archived. I think is really the most important thing, and still sort of true to our mission and what we do.
Well, now that we're in the middle of the holiday season, I imagine that a lot of people will be interested in possibly talking to, you know, their loved one, their grandparent, or
right,
their parents, aunt and uncle, during this time with an app. It seems like a great time to make use of that.
Exactly. And, you know, we just had this push with the Great Thanksgiving Listen to try to get people involved to record stories of their elders and their family or family friends. I think it's a really great opportunity for people across the country to do that. You know, obviously the holidays, you're surrounded by family, for better or for worse. And, you know, sometimes it's, even when surrounded by family, it's a good opportunity to take one of those family members aside and finally kind of get to the bottom of it and hear what their story is, hear what their childhood was like. And again, if you're not able to record in the mobile booth while we're here in the Airstream, the app is a great way to do that.
You know, with just some humble beginnings with a sound booth in Grand Central Station, I mean, what was it about that experience that really helped StoryCorps really take off into this mobile tour and be able to, you know, go to different communities across the country?
Well, I think for one, our partnership with NPR affiliate radio stations across the country has really been very important to us, because it provides us with a way of having a sort of a thoroughfare, if you will, to get people to listen to these stories. We have all these partners across the country that we work with. It's super vital. And I think when we were getting started, that one booth in Grand Central, people started hearing the sort of meaningful conversations that folks were having in Grand Central. They started getting broadcast and they started getting noticed. And then I think folks at StoryCorps started, they put their thinking cap on and thought, you know, we should really provide this service to people across the entire United States, not just in Grand Central. And I think that's sort of where the mobile tour was born, to be able to provide this access to people in places like Las Cruces, New Mexico, where, you know, we have story booths in pretty large cities across the country. They're in Atlanta, San Francisco, and Chicago. You know, Las Cruces is pretty far from all three of those cities, but we still want to be able to provide this service to people in towns like Las Cruces.
What are some of the things that you look for when you're traveling or trying to pick a destination to go to?
Yeah, so believe it or not, our Airstream is not that well insulated. So we have to sort of be down south in the winter and we have to be up north in the summertime. And all that said, we do try to, we don't just go down up and down the same route every year. We try to crisscross the country to make sure that we do get to towns like Las Cruces. We do get to regions like southern New Mexico. You know, and part of that is because we want to make sure that these parts of the country are represented in our archive. Also, we work with NPR affiliate radio stations in every city that we visit. In this case, we're working with KRWG, which is, I think this is the third time we've worked with you all. And that's part of what we look at. We also look at sort of the population of the area. Is it a fairly diverse area? Are we going to be able to bring in a wide sort of diverse swath of people into our Airstream? There are a number of different sort of characteristics of areas that we look for when we travel. And sometimes it's just, have we been here? No, let's go there. And sometimes, have we been there? Yeah, three times? Great, let's go back. And so we know that we've been treated well in Las Cruces in the past, so we're happy to come back.
Talk to me a little bit about the process, about where you decide to place the van.
Right.
How does that work out?
It's different in every community. Obviously, you know, we have sort of blanket sort of requirements that we ask for, but you're not going to find the same thing in Las Cruces that you might find in Chicago or in Omaha, Nebraska, or Denver, or wherever you may be. And so we like to try to find a place that's kind of a community hub, a place where people are familiar. Maybe it's a library, maybe it's a museum. People know where it is. It's relatively centrally located. It's easy to get to. And, you know, a very basic important thing for us is it accessible? Can people with limited mobility get there? We have our Airstream is fully accessible. We have a wheelchair lift, so if folks have limited mobility, they can get there. And hopefully, ideally, our site would reflect that also. And also the Airstream has to be powered. We have to have electricity, so that's another big part of what we look for. And usually, when I'm scouting for sites, we find a place that it all wraps together in a really nice package somehow or another. We get really lucky. And it always works. It's always great.
we live in a bilingual community here in the borderland. How can folks, that may or may not speak English or Spanish, be assured that, you know, they can go and have their stories told as well?
Sure. Great question. We have bilingual staff. I speak Spanish. Our outreach manager speaks Spanish, and we call them facilitators. They're our staff that actually run the Airstream. They're the ones that record all the stories. We'll have bilingual staff here in Las Cruces. And if someone wants to come in and tell a story in Spanish or in English, we'll be able to provide the exact same services to them as we would otherwise. Our staff would be able to walk them through the entire process, whether it's in Spanish or in English. They can fill out the forms in Spanish or English, whatever they prefer. I've spent a little bit of time on the border myself, and I know how fluid language and culture can be. So that's something that is really important to us, to make sure that our services are available to people regardless of the language that they speak.
Now, I know you have traveled the country and talked to many communities about bringing StoryCorps to their community. I'd like to give you a chance now to maybe share some memorable experiences that you may have on the road, and I'd like to ask you about some characters you also have met, because I imagine you've met quite a few characters.
Certainly do get to meet my fair share of characters. I don't want to throw anyone under the bus, but it's really wonderful to be able to travel the country and see. I try to give every city a fair shake that I visit, you know, whether it's a tiny little town in eastern Utah of 10,000 people, whether it's Las Cruces, whether it's, I was just in LA several weeks ago. And I try to go into these towns with a total blank slate and just sort of learn as much as I possibly can about the town. And, sometimes whether it's LA or New Mexico or Utah or wherever I am, I always meet these amazing characters who are involved in the community. They would do anything for their neighbor, and they have amazing stories to tell. And sometimes, it's the 6'4" cowboy that looks like he just walked out of 1870 that I would never see back on the East Coast, or sometimes it's the person in Southern Ohio that has a story about the civil rights movement that is just amazing. And so you get to hear some really wonderful stories, and you get to see we live in such a beautiful, interesting country. And it's sometimes when I travel, I'm struck by that, and I feel really lucky. It's really great.
I'd like to also, you mentioned living in this country. Now, news breaks and events unfold across the country. Mm-hmm. Has the StoryCorps trailer been anywhere near major news events, and has that had an impact and shaped whatever is going on with what people share?
That's a really good question. I think, have we been there? We have definitely visited cities that have experienced major news events. And one of the really wonderful things about our archive is that, we have now 50,000 plus stories that we've recorded. And there have been a couple of occasions when something happens in, whether it's North Carolina or Washington State or Missouri or wherever that might be, where we're able to look back in our archive and say, hey, we recorded a story in that community that speaks to what's going on here. And it really, to me, the power of our archive kind of rings true. Whether we're there physically or not, we've been to that community and we've recorded the stories of those people. And sometimes we're able to produce it and broadcast it, and it's relevant and it's important. That happens from time to time. Obviously, StoryCorps is not a news organization per se. We don't try to come out with a news piece every day, but sometimes those things overlap, and we have a really great story that happened locally that speaks on a national scale. It happens from time to time.
One of the things that is really powerful, in my opinion, about StoryCorps is that the connection between generations that seem to meet a lot of times on StoryCorps. Do you know just right off the bat when you see people signing up that, hey, this could be something pretty powerful that connects generations?
Yes and no. I think a lot of the time people like to use StoryCorps for that sort of bridging generations and having young folks speak to their elders or having people from different walks of life in any way, shape, or form to speak to each other. You know, going in to have seeing people sign up, you know, you can never really tell what they're going to talk about immediately. We just try to provide the space for people to come in and have a meaningful conversation. And, you know, it may not necessarily be a conversation that we're going to broadcast immediately, but that the time that those folks had in our Airstream to record that story, to share that 40 minutes of uninterrupted time, I think is something that's really invaluable. Like you said, in the past, it's really worked wonders for people to sort of bridge a generation gap or bridge other kinds of gap where people get to learn about the experiences that someone else went through in a different time or a different place.
Okay, we just have about a minute left, but I'd like to get the information out one more time to the folks about where they can go to reserve a spot on the StoryCorps.
Yep, so folks can go to StoryCorps.org to reserve a spot with us. You just go up to the top of the page and click on the little button that says record, and there will be a drop-down menu that has Las Cruces there, and you should be able to sign up for a time there. Very easy. And appointments will be available starting December 21st. So be there 10 a.m. sharp Mountain Time to sign up for your StoryCorps appointment with us.
Now, I know also on your website you have some ways where people can listen to StoryCorps of the past. Is that correct?
Yep. Every story we've ever broadcast in the past is on our website. And so we have a handful actually from New Mexico. So if you want to go to our website, search those New Mexico stories. They've got some really, really great ones. And the same goes for all of the other states and cities that we visited. It's totally searchable. Every story you've ever broadcast is available on our website.
All right. Well, I want to thank you very much for taking the time and joining us.
Yeah, my pleasure.
All right. Now, we will have a link at our website, krwg.org, for you to go and reserve a spot with StoryCorps. So we'll keep you updated on that. Also, like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We'll be sure to keep you updated on all the changes that are happening with StoryCorps that is coming to Las Cruces in January. I'm Anthony Moreno. Thanks for joining us.